Welcome, Cross Community. I'm Matt. I'm the campus pastor at Pecola. I'm glad to be here today. I've been coming over here about every, 6 months or so for a while. Actually, today is kind of a cool day. I know Brian's been celebrating stuff before every sermon for the last little bit. Today is a celebration for me, not to make it all about me or anything, but it's a celebration for me because 5 years ago this week, I actually preached my first sermon here. Now, that was the second sermon I'd ever preached in my life. Depending on who you talk to, it was good or bad or whatever. Brian, after my first sermon, we were doing two services at the time. After the first service, I asked him, what should I change or do different? He said, just cut 20 minutes, and I don't care where. I think I went about 50 minutes. People were literally trying to park and come in for the second service, and we were still in here listening to me. Josh wasn't quite as kind to me. He said he'll just kill my mic and come take me off the stage physically if needed. So hopefully I will not go that long this time, but we never know. We'll see. We find ourselves in the book of John. We've been here for a while, and the thing that I think is kind of cool about this little piece of text is it kind of shows us something that's very, very basic, okay? And as I thought about basic things, I kind of thought of basic things that kind of go together, okay? So just in your mind, you don't have to say them out loud because I know we're Baptists and it's hard to say things out loud in church. So just in your mind, you know, what is kind of the first thing you think of if I say the word salt? Most people would probably say pepper, right? Salt and pepper, they kind of go together, kind of basics. You know, if I say milk, generally most people would say cookies, okay? Milk and cookies. You might say cereal, you may be one of those guys, but milk and cookies, they kind of go together. Eggs kind of go with what? Bacon, right? Somebody said it. Someone's not Baptist in here. I just heard them. Bacon. Try it. They're just kind of basic things that go together. You know, you can think of toast. Toast goes with butter. There's just all these things. If I say love, the first thing I hope comes to your mind is marriage, right? Love and marriage, they kind of go hand in hand. But what we find is we walk through life, sometimes we don't really get what the basics are. Maybe we get parts of them, maybe we get a piece of them, but we don't get both sides of the story, okay? So that's what leads us sometimes that if we're in a marriage, we think we're married, but there's not really love there, right? And so we don't really try to strive for that love, and we wonder why the marriage fails, right? Wonder why we fall flat on our face, because we're trying to do one without the other. Other side of that coin can be that we're love with one another, but we decide to live together, right? We don't get married. We don't kind of do both things. And then we wonder why that falls apart. And so kind of what I want to look at today is two very basic things that are in Christianity that a lot of times you may get one of them. I think some of us in here may get all of them or both sides of the coin, but for a lot of people, this is something, and myself included, is something that you might struggle with gaining both sides of. Now, we know the very basics of Christianity is what? It's salvation, right? So that's like the bare bones basic. But what if I told you there is something that goes along with salvation that is equally important as the salvation, is something that's going to let you live your life in such a way where you feel free to live the life that God has intended for you to live. Would you be interested in that? Yeah, right. You'd be some, you know, y'all don't really seem interested. I mean, come on. You'd be very interested, I hope, that if we can add something, and I'm not saying add to salvation, but we can add something in there to let you know it's there already, it'll help you live more securely and more happily as you go through life. So if you will, turn with me to chapter 17 of John. We've been here in John for some time. And just to kind of lay the groundwork of where we're at, we have watched Jesus over the last few chapters talk very blatantly and very honestly to his disciples, okay? We know as we walk through the book of John that many times he talked in parables, he said things that they didn't understand, but over this last little bit, he's been very blatant to tell them exactly what he intends them to understand, okay? He's told them plainly and easily kind of what is going on, where he's going, and what's going to happen. And the last little bit that we've walked through, he's told them that as he goes away, things are going to get rough for him. Things are going to get very difficult, that people are going to come against them simply because they're Christians. They're going to come against them. He said at one point, he says, you know that they hated me, therefore they will hate you. Okay, if you're after my way, if you follow my words, if you do the things I've told you to do, they're going to hate you. And so he's told them there's going to be a lot of turmoil. He's told them they're all going to run away. They're all going to disperse, that none of them are going to stay close to him. And he even goes as far to say that as he goes to the cross, as he goes away to do the thing that he was come to in, with every intent to do, as he goes to do that, all of his disciples are going to run away. He even goes as far as basically says that Peter's going to completely deny him. And so we don't find them in this wonderful kind of rainbow place, right? You know, we find them in kind of a dark place. And as we see this dark place, God, or Christ in himself, he decides that it's time that he needs to go and he needs to kind of begin to pray. So in verse 1 there, we're going to start, it says, Jesus spoke these things and lifting up his eyes to heaven, he said, Father, the hour has come, glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. So all through the Bible, all through this text we've been reading, several occasions, Jesus, when approached, has said, it's not my time yet. This is not about me yet. It's not my time. Don't do that. Don't talk about me. Don't say these things about me, because it's not really my time yet. And so we find right here that he's saying flat out, he's going before his Father and saying, okay, Father, it is time. It's time for me to fulfill what you've sent me for. It's time for me to do that one thing that you have sent me to do. And as he talks on, he says, even as you gave him authority over all flesh, that to all whom you've given him, he may give eternal life. So he's talking, he says that it's time for me to go and do what I need to do because you've given me authority over these people, and because of that, you've given me the ability to give them eternal life. Says that this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So he begins his prayer by saying to God the Father, he says, you've sent me here for a purpose. You've sent me here for a certain time, and that time has come. And as I go to do this thing you've sent me to do, which we now know was for him to go to the cross, die for our sins, as he does that, he does it to bring salvation to us. Now, anybody that's been to church more than one time probably understands that we believe that you need to be saved by somebody. We need to be saved by this Lord and Savior Jesus Christ who came to this world for express purpose to do this. You know, we know this if we've been here very often at all. And we know this salvation comes through this sacrifice that was made, that as he went to the cross, he died on the cross, our sins were placed upon him, and then his righteousness was placed upon us. It's like this trade. And as we get this righteousness, we also get a justification in ourselves. We get this kind of legal verdict placed on us that says that even though you have sinned, even though you've committed all these atrocities, because Christ died in your place, we now see you as justified. That's what God says. And so the first part of the kind of thing that we look at, the basics of Christianity is that we need salvation. And we understand how to receive salvation. We know why we need salvation typically. But there's something else to it that a lot of times we just don't really get. If you go on with me, we're going to read on from chapter 8 on. It says, for the words which you gave me, I have given to them. So everything that Jesus told to his disciples was given to him by God. So they weren't his own words. They weren't his own thing. He just was showing who the Father was. He was showing what the Father says. He was giving to them everything that the Father had given to him. Goes on, it says, and they received them and truly understood that I came forth from you, and they believed that you sent me. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is in chapter 6 of John, and it's this kind of discourse between Jesus and the disciples, and there's been this time where there was a great falling away. And all these disciples that had been following Jesus, they all decided that what he said was just too difficult to follow, that his words that came from the Father were too difficult, and they just couldn't do it anymore. And it says that Jesus looks at the 12, and he says, will you go also? And as he says it, Peter, you know, the kind of rough guy, the tough guy, the guy who's a fisherman that was really quick to fight, quick to cuss, quick to do the things that, you know, a rough guy does. He looks at Jesus and says, we don't know where else we would even go because you hold the words of truth. We believe that you're the Son of God. And so what Jesus is echoing there is he's saying that what Peter says is what all of the disciples says, that they believe that he is the Son of God. And Jesus goes on, he says, and he's praying to the Father once again. He says, I ask on behalf of the disciples. I do not ask on behalf of the world, but of those whom you have given me, for they are yours. So he's talking, he said, I'm asking on the behalf of those who are saved. Okay, that's what we're going to look at. We're looking at those who have already gained salvation through the Word of God, through an understanding of who God is. And he says, all things that are mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. It says, I am no longer in the world, and yet they themselves are in the world, and I come to you. So he's saying, I'm getting ready to leave. I'm getting ready to be out of here. I'm going to go to the cross. I will no longer be able to walk with them. I'm out of here. I'm done. I've fulfilled my purpose. So now, Holy Father, keep them in your name. Now, this is not just an arbitrary little statement. This is one of the most powerful statements you will ever read in the Bible. This is something that is so completely basic, but all of us almost always miss. And that is the mere fact that Jesus, when he's praying for the men who walked with him for 3.5 years, men that should understand the salvation, should understand the gospel better than anyone else, he understood that when he went away, things were going to get bad. He understood that people were going to come against him. He understood that they would not have an easy life. He also understood that they were prone to run. They were prone to run away. If you look at what happened as he went to the cross, they all dispersed, they ran away, and they just went back to where they started. Since Peter was trying to be a fisherman again, he didn't know what else to do, so he went back to what just kind of felt easy. And he says that as he saw that, as he understood that was going to happen, he said, Father, will you hold on to them? Will you hold on to them? When they're too weak to hold on, will you hold on? He said, because I'm going away. I'm no longer with them. I can't walk with them daily. I can't do the things that they need me to do to help them stay secure. So God, will you make them secure? See, if you don't go away with anything today, if you don't understand anything I say, if I babble and just make no sense, go away with this. Jesus brings you salvation. He bought it for you. He bought your salvation. But God is going to bring you security. See, as Jesus brought salvation, he understood that that's sufficient in what it is, but he also understood that they needed God to hold on to them. The best example I can come up with, when my children were young, and we would go places, I kind of had a ritual. My family knows to this day that if we're walking down a sidewalk, I'm going to push them out of the way to get closest to the road. And the reason is, if a car veers sideways, I'm getting hit first. I'm dad, I'm getting hit first. But when my kids were little, obviously my son is taller than me. I will not hold his hand now because it would be very uncomfortable. But as they were younger, I can remember holding Abigail's hand. She was little. And the one thing I never allowed her to do is I didn't let her hold my hand. I held hers. Have you ever let a little kid hold your hand and think they're going to stay there more than about 10 seconds? It just doesn't happen, does it? They run off. They will not hold on to your hand very long. But by golly, I can hold on tighter than she can. And if she tries to go on the road, I'm not going to let her. And if someone tries to come after her, they're coming over the top of my big dead body. And see, here's the thing. That's how God is for you. See, your salvation is through Christ, through what he did on a cross, a horrific, agonizing death because your sin was that bad. But your security is in a God who loves you like a good father. He loves you like a good father. He loves you enough to know that you will do stupid stuff. I've done stupid stuff. I'm still doing stupid stuff. I stand on a stage every week and I wonder why God still lets me do it sometimes. And the reason he lets you do it is because he loves me and he knows that I am just in this world of sin, and until I get to heaven, sanctification will not be complete. And because of that, he knows he needs to hold on to me like a good daddy. See, some of you don't have good daddies. You never had a good daddy. You didn't have a good mama. You didn't have good parents. You didn't have anybody. And so when we talk about God as a good father, you don't even comprehend it. But here's what I'm here to tell you is God is a good father. He's not a horrible father. He's not a terrible father. He's one that will look out for you no matter what. That no matter how far you run, no matter how far you stray, if you are in him, if you have been saved by his son, by the sacrifice he made, that's enough. And that he's going to hold on to you. And he may let you go a little ways. He may run with you for a while, but eventually he's going to snag you up and he's going to tell you it's time to come back. He's going to tell you it's time to come back. See, I don't speak of this as someone who has just read a book. I know I seem to have it all together up here. I just kind of have that air, right? I have been baptized 4 times. 4. Can anybody beat me on that one? No one beat me the first service. 4 times. You know why I've been baptized 4 times? Because I always felt like I fell away. I would commit some sin that I thought was way too big for God to ever continue to forgive, and felt like I had to come back to him and get saved again. And then, if you get saved, you got to get baptized, so you get rebaptized. And it was just constant condemnation on my life. It was this constant agony in my life thinking, have I done so much, God will not take me back. And see, what I didn't understand is I understood salvation. I got that. I knew that one. I had that one down. I'd done it many times, okay? I had said that prayer. I could repeat it to you. I could do whatever you want to with that whole sinner's prayer thing. But when it comes to the fact that I need to know there was security in God, when I need to know that I was never going to be strong enough to hold myself there, when I came to that understanding that Christ had prayed to his Father for me, that he would hold me secure, see, a lot of that condemnation, it went away. Now, what I'm saying is not license to sin. I'm not saying you get saved and you just run the roads. You do whatever you want to do. That is not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that we as Christians will fall. We will fail. We will be like Peter and we will do dumb stuff. That's all, just Peter. Peter was so dumb at times, Paul called him out. Paul said, Peter, you're an idiot. Quit doing that. I mean, that's how bad Peter was at times. And this is after the fact that he had went on. I mean, that's how he was. God knew that about Peter, and he loved him anyway, and he kept him secure. And he even said, I'll build my church on you. See, some of you in here need to understand that there's not just salvation, there's security. See, the way this applies to you is if you're here today and you don't know Christ, if you've never known Christ, today's the day to do it. See, if you've never come to that saving relationship with Jesus, if you've never come to that understanding of who he is, then today's the way to do that. See, we need to let you know that there's this thing called the gospel. This thing called the gospel that says that Christ went to a cross, suffered an agonizing death, a death so horrific that if I were to describe it today, some of you would get up and leave. If I were to go into vivid detail about what happened to this man because of the sins I have committed and I will commit, you would leave because it's so terrible of a thing. It was said the Romans had just made death an art. They had guys that all they did was live to do this. And that's the death he died for your sins. And if you're here today, it's not because you just happened to come to this church today. It's because God drew you here through his Spirit to come to know him. And see, some of you are not right there because you've already did that. So you understood that basic truth. The basic truth you don't understand is the fact that you're secure in who you are. That you have a Father in heaven that right now has reached down. He is holding onto your hand. And whatever you're going through, he's going to help you. Because some of you are going through horrible things. Some of your lives are upside down right now. Some of you need a Father who will come beside you, who will hold you. Not just hold your hand, but hold you. Because you don't even feel like you can stand up anymore. You need to realize you have a Father that loves you enough to walk beside you, to carry you if needed, because you're worth something to him. You're worth something to him. You're worth so much that his son went to die to show that he loved you. And now he's going to secure you in who he is. See, the way that looks sometimes is it's not some weird mystical thing. See, we always think of God holding your hand like, well, it's some weird, I got to do trances and all this stuff. It's not that. Sometimes it means your home group walks beside you as you walk through something bad. See, I think God sent home groups and sent people in your life. He sent communities into your life so that when you're having hard times, They're going to carry some of the burden. They're going to carry some of the load. See, if you're walking through this all and you're without people to help you, God will still be there. God will still hold you. But sometimes you're missing out on what He really intends to do. I don't know how many times my home group, they've come to my house and I thought I was there to lift them up and they lifted me up. I don't know how many times I've asked them to pray and they're the ones there with me, walking beside me, encouraged me, strengthened me. See, that's what God wants to do. See, it's basics. This isn't hard. This isn't trying to understand the Trinity. This isn't understanding the glory of God. This isn't understanding any of the hard concepts that honestly even the really intellectual guys struggle with. These are the bare basics. These are the salt and pepper of Christianity. This is saying that you need salvation and you need security. And you need both of them. You don't need one or the other. You need them both. I have walked away from God before with no intention of ever going back. I've told the story before that I honestly sat on my couch for about 6 months, fed up with everything. And for whatever reason, God loved me enough, for one, to send a wife that knew I was acting stupid but didn't say I was acting stupid, who loved my kids enough to take them to church, and loved her husband enough to put men and women into his life that would encourage him to get back on the right track. See, I'm here today because of God's security. The day that I have to hold my own security, the day that I have to do it on my own, I take the mic off and I go home and I start watching TV or playing Xbox because I'll never be able to do it. And here's the other funny thing about that. Neither will you. See, I don't care how strong you are, how high you are, how far you think you've traveled, salvation isn't all there is. You also got to have a security God. If you bow your heads with me. Father God, I just come before you and I just pray, God, for each person in this room. God, these are the bare bones basics of it all, Lord. Salvation and security, God. Salvation, that your Son died for us, God, that you're here to receive us, that you're here to forgive us of those sins, those horrible, horrible things, God, that we've either committed or thought or the lust we've ran after. And God's security to let us know that as we walk out of the midst of that junk, you're there holding on tight to us. God, I pray for my brothers and sisters today, God, as their struggle, as they have questions and problems and concerns, that God, you would help them to see you as a loving Father, God, that just wants to hold them tight. Just thank you, God, for the grace, God. We weaken grace so much. Just thank you for your grace. We ask this all in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. As the band plays, if you don't know God, it's time to come to know Him. If you don't have that saving understanding of who God is and what He did through His Son, today's the day. And if you have never felt secure, if you feel condemned as a Christian, well, today's the day for you to come to an understanding that your Father loves you enough to hold on to you. This area's open, people to pray with you. As the band plays, that's what we'd ask you to do.